Simon & Schuster Audio presents Halo, The Flood by William C. Dietz. Read by Todd McLaren.
Prologue. 0103 hours. September 19, 2552. Military calendar. UNSC cruiser Pillar of Autumn. Location unknown. Tech Officer Third Class Sam Marcus swore as the intercom roused him from fitful sleep. He rubbed his blurry eyes and glanced at the mission clock, bolted to the wall above his bunk. He'd been asleep for 3 hours. His first sleep cycle in 36 hours, damn it. Worse, this was the first time since the ship had jumped that he'd been able to fall asleep at all.
Jesus, he muttered. This better be good.
The old man had put the tech crews on triple shifts after the Pillar of Autumn jumped away from reach. The ship was a mess after the battle, and what was left of the engineering crews worked around the clock to keep the aging cruiser in one piece. Nearly one-third of the tech staff had died during the flight from Reach, and every department was running a skeleton crew. Everyone else went into the freezer, of course. Non-essential personnel always got an ice nap during a slipspace jump. In over 200 combat cruises, Marcus had clocked fewer than 72 hours in cryostorage. Right now, though, he was so tired that even the discomfort of cryo-revival sounded appealing, if it meant that he could manage some uninterrupted sleep. Of course, it was difficult to complain. Captain Keyes was a brilliant tactician, and everyone aboard the Autumn knew just how close they'd come to destruction when Reach fell to the enemy. A major naval base destroyed, millions dead or dying as the Covenant burned the planet to a cinder, and one of Earth's few remaining defenses transformed into corpses and molten slag. All in all, they'd been damned lucky to get away. But Sam couldn't help but feel that everyone on the Autumn was living on borrowed time. The intercom buzzed again, and Sam swung himself out of the bunk. He jabbed at the comm control.
Marcus here, he growled. I'm sorry to wake you, Sam, but I need you down in Cryo 2.
Tech Chief Shepard sounded exhausted.
It's important.
Cryo 2? Sam repeated, puzzled.
What's the emergency, Tom? I'm not a cryo specialist. I can't give you specifics, Sam. The captain wants it kept off the comm,
Shepard replied, his voice almost a whisper.
Just in case we have eavesdroppers.
Sam winced at the tone in his superior's voice. He'd known Tom Shepard since the academy, and had never heard the man sound so grim.
Look, Shepard said, I need someone I can depend on. Like it or not, that's you, pal. You've cross-checked on cryo systems.
Sam sighed.
Months ago, but yes. I'm sending a feed to your terminal, Sam, Shepard continued. It'll answer some of your questions anyway. Dump it to a portable pad, grab your gear, and get down here.
Roger, Sam said.
He stood, shrugged into his uniform tunic, and stepped over to his terminal. He activated the computer and waited for the upload from Shepard. As he waited, his eyes locked on a small 2D photograph taped to the edge of the screen. Sam brushed his fingers against the photo. The pretty young woman frozen in the picture smiled back at him. The terminal chimed as the feed from Shepard appeared in Sam's message queue.
Receiving the feed, Chief, he called out to the intercom pickup.
He opened the file. A frown creased his tired features as a new message scrolled across his screen. File encrypted, eyes only, Marcus, Samuel, NSN, 18273-18209-Mike. Decryption key, personalized, Ellen's anniversary. He glanced back at the picture of his wife. He hadn't seen Ellen in almost 3 years, since his last shore leave on Earth, in fact. He didn't know anyone on active duty who'd been able to see their loved ones for years. The war simply didn't allow for it. Sam's frown deepened. UNSC personnel generally avoided talking about the people back home. The war had been going badly for so long that morale was rock bottom. Thinking about the home front only made things worse. The fact that Tom had personalized the security encoding was unusual enough. Reminding Sam of his wife in the process was completely out of character for Chief Shepard. Someone was being security conscious to the point of paranoia. He punched in a series of numbers, the date of his wedding, and enabled the decryption suite. In seconds, the screen filled with schematics and tech readouts. His practiced eye scanned the file, and adrenaline suddenly spiked through his fatigue like a bolt of lightning.
"Christ," he said, his voice suddenly hoarse. "Tom, is this what, who I think it is?" "Damn right. Get down to Cryo 2 on the double, Sam. We've got an important package to thaw out, and we drop back into real space soon."
"On my way," he said. He killed the intercom connection, his exhaustion forgotten. Sam quickly dumped the tech file to his portable comm pad and deleted the original from his computer. He strode toward the door to his cabin, then stopped. He snatched Ellen's picture from the workstation, almost as an afterthought, and shoved it into his pocket. He sprinted for the lift. If the captain wanted the inhabitant of Cryo 2 revived, it meant that Keyes believed that the situation was about to go from bad to worse. Or it already had. Unlike vessels designed by humans, in which the command area was almost always located toward the ship's bow, Covenant ships were constructed in a more logical fashion, which meant that their control rooms were buried deep within heavily armored hulls, making them impervious to anything less than a mortal blow. The differences did not end there. Rather than surround themselves with all manner of control interfaces, plus the lesser beings required to staff them, the elites preferred to command from the center of an aesthetically barren platform held in place by a latticework of opposing gravity beams. However, none of these things were at the forefront of Shipmaster Orna Fulsimi's mind as he stood at the center of his destroyer's control room and stared at the data projections which appeared to float in front of him. One showed the ringworld, Halo. Near that, a tiny arrow tracked the interloper's course. The second projection displayed a schematic titled Human Attack Ship, Type C-11. A third scrolled a constant flow of targeting data and sensor readouts. He fought a moment of revulsion. That these filthy primates somehow merited an actual name, let alone names for their inferior constructs, galled him to his core. It was perverse. Names implied legitimacy, and the vermin deserved only extermination. The humans had names for his own kind, elites, as well as the lesser races of the Covenant, jackals, grunts, hunters. The appalling temerity of the filthy creatures that they would dare name his people with their harsh, barbaric tongue was beyond the pale. He paused and regained his composure. Fulsimi clicked his lower mandibles, the equivalent of a shrug, and mentally recited one of the true sayings. "Such is the prophet's decree," he thought. One didn't question such things, even when one was a shipmaster. The prophets had assigned names to the enemy craft, and he would honor their decrees. Any less was a disgraceful dereliction of duty. Like all of his kind, the Covenant officer appeared to be larger than he actually was, due to the armor that he wore. It gave him an angular, somewhat hunched appearance, which, when combined with a heavy, pugnacious jaw, caused him to look like what he was, a very dangerous warrior. His voice was calm and well-modulated as he addressed the situation. "They must have followed one of our ships. The culprit will be found and put to death at once, Exalted." The being who floated next to Fulsimi bobbed slightly as a gust of air nudged his heavily swathed body. He wore a tall, ornate headpiece made of metal.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.